And now, in December of 1814, a British fleet of almost 15,000 veteran troops and 50 ships, fresh from their victories against Napoleon, converges on this vulnerable spot. At the helm is Admiral Alexander Cochrane, recently appointed Commander-in-Chief of the North American Station. He is a seasoned professional, a consummate bureaucrat with a distaste for all things American. He expresses an ardor for the coming attack.
It will be to my great satisfaction to give them a complete drubbing before peace is made and see the command of the Mississippi wrested from them.
If the British capture New Orleans, they can use it as a bargaining chip to force American concessions. For the commander of the American forces at New Orleans, the possibility is unthinkable. It is the Revolutionary War that left 13-year-old Andrew Jackson an orphan, and he still bears scars on his face and hand, said to have come from an English officer who tried to force the young rebel to shine his boots. As Jackson grows up, he becomes known for his quick temper, his readiness to duel and brawl. He takes offense from no man. Now with the British once again on his doorstep, Jackson is quick to enter the fray.
The amazing thing with Jackson is that he reacts immediately. He's an aggressive individual, and he decides that he will go out and meet the enemy on his own terms and attempt to defeat him.
Jackson's daring night attack gives the British pause, but the odds are still very much in their favor. When Napoleon Bonaparte abdicates his throne in early 1814, the British are able to throw almost 20,000 veteran troops into the fighting in North America.
The British Army is the most skillful, the best equipped, and the most successful army the world has ever seen. This is an army that has defeated Napoleon, and his troops have been outmanned and outgeneraled by the British Army and its officers.
Britain has at its disposal the best and most experienced combat officers in the world. By contrast, the American Army is a diverse, if not motley, group.
Throughout history, we've always come to believe that the Americans at New Orleans are a bunch of coonskin-wearing riflemen. New Orleans is perhaps the greatest conglomeration of individuals in American history.
It consists of French and Spanish-speaking militias. It consists of militias from Tennessee, Kentucky, from Mississippi. It consists of free men of color. It consists of Native Americans. It also included regulars from the United States Army, the Marines, and seamen of the United States Navy. This was one of the most diverse forces, if not the most diverse force, ever brought together to protect and fight for the United States.
The Creoles of New Orleans muster up five companies of men from some of the finest families in the city. They are to stand side by side with ragged and near destitute frontiersmen.
There were a couple of thousand Kentucky militiamen that had come down to join Jackson. Most of them arrived in rags, and they were weaponless, not a single firearm among most of them. They had to scrounge the city to find anything to give them, and only about 500 of these men got these weapons. The rest of them were used in a reserve line and given farm tools and clubs. In case the British broke through, they would be a last-ditch effort to fight back.
Jackson does not let any personal biases stand in the way of taking volunteers from the New Orleans populace. Though a slaveholder himself, Jackson willingly adds 500 free men of color to his ranks. He even demands that they be paid the same compensation as their white counterparts, $124 and 160 acres of land. The notorious Indian fighter also convinces the local Choctaw leader to organize a group of his warriors into a company. And portions of the 7th U.S. Infantry and 44th U.S. Infantry are here as well.
The individuals who are in the regular service, who are there because it's their job, they have to be, they are the instruments of government policy.
There is one more group from Louisiana which will play a part in the coming battle. They're a rough and lawless group of smugglers and privateers known as the Barratarians. No one, American or British, is quite sure whose side they will take. Late December 1814. The unseasonably warm winter weather is finally turning chill. In Belgium, American and British negotiators have agreed on a treaty. But that word has not reached Washington, let alone New Orleans. Here the streets are deserted. The entire city has mobilized to block an impending British invasion of this key port. They come together in a force as diverse as the city itself. Army regulars, free blacks, Creoles, and the ragged frontiersmen they call Dirty Shirts. But there is one wild card among them yet to be played. They are called Barratarians, named for Barratarian Bay, where they are thought to congregate. These are the smugglers who haunt the swamps and back streets of New Orleans. Their nominal leader is a French refugee from Santo Domingo named Jean Lafitte.
Lafitte is an amazing character. He's arrived from nowhere and taken over the underworld of New Orleans. He's become socially acceptable in certain circles because he can supply what the New Orleanians want. But let's not be mistaken about Lafitte. Lafitte is a pirate, and that entails being a murderer.
But Lafitte has resources that far outweigh his unsavory reputation, a vast stock of powder and shot, the very thing that Jackson needs, and control of Grande Terre, which offers the perfect location to oversee all backwater approaches to New Orleans. After entertaining overtures from both Great Britain and America to join the fray, Lafitte decides to side with the Americans. Perhaps he feels they are less likely to interfere in his primary livelihood, the plundering of Spanish ships. But even as the Americans consolidate their disparate troops, just a few miles away at the Villers plantation, the British are welcoming their own reinforcements. On Christmas Day, British Commander Major General Sir Edward Michael Pakenham, the Duke of Wellington's own brother-in-law, has arrived to take command.
He's a young man, 38, but he's spent all of his life in the army. He can see that maybe it was all leading up to this battle that he's about to fight in the Americas. He got into the Peninsula War. He was fighting under Wellington. Wellington made him his adjutant general. Then at the Battle of Salamanca, it was Pakenham who led the attack. Even Wellington said of him, "My partiality for him nevertheless does not lead me astray when I say he is one of the best that we have."
Soon, Pakenham will have 10,000 troops at his immediate disposal, with several thousand in reserve, and large numbers of sailors and marines waiting aboard the British ships 50 miles distant. But the British fleet has to anchor far from landfall, due to the shallow waters around New Orleans. Their troops and supplies must be rowed some 68 miles to a landing spot, only to face a hard slog through heavy mud. And once on land, the artillery is almost impossible to move.
British Army, for example, has to muscle everything 60 miles in open boats, through swamps, through mud. It is a back-breaking and amazing physical achievement what they do.
This is a floodplain so close to the water table, the ground is sodden. So when the cannon finally come, they have to come over this very same ground. It's not impossible to move the cannon in, but it's almost impossible. The heaviest artillery, in fact, are on naval carriages with short wheels, very small wheels that pick up even more mud and have to be almost dragged as if they were on sleds through this great thick mud.
Jackson has made sure that his army has the best position on the battlefield and has flooded the plain in front of his ramparts. His well-constructed earth and wooden breastworks run almost a mile from the Mississippi River to the wooded swamp.
Jackson has chosen the ideal location. We have the river to one side. We have a cypress swamp to our rear. We can build these parapets in such a way that the men can be protected against an assault by bayonets. We can step forward and have a rolling fire of continual musketry and rifle fire. We will bring them into a funnel.
Though only a few miles of swampland separates the Americans from the British troops, there has been scant contact between the two armies. There is a lone exception.
The Americans are using somewhat unorthodox techniques by European standards of sending out American Indians, primarily Choctaws, and hunting parties of militia to render their pickets useless.
Well, of course, anybody sneaking up on one of your men at night and scalping him or slitting his throat is going to put bad thoughts in your head, no matter what experiences you may have had before.
One British officer decries this demoralizing practice.
Those savages have no knowledge of how war should be fought. In Europe, when two armies face each other, the outposts of neither are molested. These dirty shirts entertain no such chivalric notions.
The frigid weather also begins to take its toll on the British troops.
The winter is one of the worst in history for New Orleans. It's freezing cold, there is sleet and rain. One of the main problems, the two West Indies regiments, these were black troops from the West Indies fighting in the British Army. They had never experienced cold weather, were not acclimated, and were not really equipped, and many of them just simply died from exposure.
On December 28th, General Pakenham has had enough. He decides to break the uneasy standoff with a test of the American forces he terms a reconnaissance in force. This will help him pinpoint any weaknesses in Jackson's line and better plan his attack. There is a sudden roar as the British cannons come to life. The American artillery responds in kind.
The major difference between the American and British artillery is that the Americans had cotton bales available to them, and they were able to entrench their cannon positions by using these cotton bales as a base to absorb the high groundwater.
The British are having major problems trying to keep their artillery from sinking into the mud and being able to serve them.
One British lieutenant describes the impact of the American fire.
The Americans are excellent shots, as well with artillery as rifles. A tremendous cannonade mowed down our ranks and deafened us with its roar.
Colonel Robert Rennie and elements of the 21st Foot make an aggressive attack on Jackson's left flank. A few of the American riflemen in the woods are overconfident and are felled by British muskets. The American line begins to crumble. Rennie's men now have an opportunity to penetrate the American battle line. But just as victory seems in sight, Colonel Rennie receives the order to retreat. Pakenham's reconnaissance is over. The next day, unaware that peace has been declared a week before, General Pakenham decides he has no choice but to stage a frontal attack. His troops prepare scaling ladders and bundles of cane that will be thrown into the deep ditch in front of the American breastworks so it can be crossed.
General Pakenham's plan is sound. All the general did was use a tried and true formula, basically forming his men into columns of companies as a giant battering ram, where he could move a large mass of men forward and then deploy and take the works.
The British had been attacking and capturing fortified positions against Napoleon for years. These fortifications were 10 times more massive than Jackson's relatively puny little wall of mud. There was nothing to it. His plan was based on written out military books that had analyzed such situations before. It was by the book.
It basically involved seizing the American position on the west bank of the Mississippi River, capturing the American artillery on that side of the river, and before dawn, his main force sweeping up the east bank of the Mississippi River over top of Jackson's entrenchments with a captured American artillery on the west bank, pounding the Americans at the same time.
If everything goes to plan, he should have two columns of attack piling into the American line at the same time. Jackson will not have one attack to deal with, but two. He must weaken his line somewhere, and Pakenham will go for that weakness.
The odds seem skewed toward the British. In the early dawn of January 8th, almost 10,000 seasoned British troops will attack a ragtag militia only half their size. But what the British can't know is that nothing on that frigid January morning will go as planned.